A magician at a wedding reception pulls out a deck of playing cards and asks a member of the audience to pick any card at random. She selects the seven of clubs. He then shuffles the deck. What is the probability of the magician picking the correct card from the deck? If you think the answer is 1 in 52, you are a victim of the condition known in psychology as fundamental attribution error, or FAE. This is when we try to understand the behavior of others by attributing too much to character and disposition and too little to situation and context. When we seek a better balance, we can adopt a more realistic view of events around us.
Now, the fundamental attribution error, therefore, really relates in an intimate way to the central task of psychology. Psychology is interested in sort of teasing apart the role of personality and the role of the situation, but every individual layperson in their everyday life is trying to do exactly the same thing when they see behavior. We're trying to say, why did the actor do it? What do I learn about the actor? What implications might it have for the way other people would behave? And the fundamental attribution error refers to the fact that people, especially in our culture, make a systematic error, or at least show a systematic bias. We tend to be dispositionists or trait theorists. We tend to think that behavior is a result of the person. And in believing that, and in making that inference, we often undervalue or overlook the importance of the immediate social situation that's impinging on the actor.
Fundamental attribution error is a common human trait. If the magician could not select the correct playing card at the wedding, his trick would have not have worked, and there would have been little point in hiring him. Therefore, the probability of him picking the correct card in this context must be nearer 100%. Let us take another example from psychology. Here is Dr. Alan Stroof talking about the attachment theory. Is he also guilty of fundamental attribution error?
There are thousands of interesting findings in our study, but two or three that I think are especially intriguing. One concerns, since we're able to look both at peer influences and at parenting influences, we're able to consider things like, do peers have influences on some kinds of things more than parents, and parents have maybe influences on some kinds of things more than peers? To give you one particular example, we're now looking at the romantic relationships of our young adults. And what we find is that parenting history, especially the quality of early attachment experiences, predict things like the capacity for intimacy that the individuals bring to the relationship and the capacity to deal with emotions in the relationship. Whereas our peer measures actually predict better than attachment to how well these individuals negotiate conflict in their interactions. So negotiating conflict and resolving a conflict through interaction is something that you may gain a great deal of background for in your peer relationships, even though your parent relationships have set that up by giving you a fundamental belief in the importance of being connected with others and a capacity for trust and a comfort with intimacy and emotion in relationships.
Sroof seems to be attributing different functions to parents and peers. But this challenges the accepted view of the case study of the World War II orphans known as the Bulldog Bank children. Their parents had been killed not long after their imprisonment. Conditions were very hard, food was scarce. It would have been impossible to form any strong bonds with adults, as none would have been around for long enough. After the war, they eventually arrived in the Lake District, when the youngest was approximately 3 years and the oldest 3 years and 10 months old. They had endured awful living conditions and received virtually no stimulation of any kind. Yet the impact of the stress was to make the children adapt and find substitute affections from each other. When Sroof attributes the different functions to different people, is he not really describing the effects of the differing contexts children find themselves in as they grow older, rather than any innate contribution peers may make as opposed to parents? Similarly, when Bowlby was forming his ideas about attachment after the Second World War, he was pacing the wards of a children's hospital. He heard the children crying out for their mothers and attributed their frustration to the parents' absence before considering the circumstances they found themselves in. The initial research that led him to develop his ideas on attachment was called 44 Juvenile Thieves, Their Characters and Home Life. Instead of the socio-economic backgrounds, he attributed what he called affectionless psychopathy to maternal deprivation. His often quoted view was that mother love in infancy is as important for mental health as are vitamins and proteins for physical health. This led him to make further claims about the catastrophic effects of early separation, especially on infants entrusted to institutions. Bowlby's view of attachment is still in vogue with social workers, and his books are required learning on some training courses. Social workers can argue, as in the death of baby P, that taking the child away from his or her family could do more harm than good. But this idea can also contribute to a laissez-faire approach to intervention in the family, thereby undermining the purpose of child protection. This is not to say, of course, that all fathers are innocent, as the terrible case of the man who repeatedly raped his two daughters proves. According to the Daily Mail newspaper, Baby P's mother gave birth to a child in jail whilst awaiting trial. Council officials told police it was against the human rights of the mother to take the newborn girl away from her. A social worker even told officers, "We need to let her bond." Scotland Yard eventually overruled Haringey. A source close to the investigation told the Times newspaper, "There is no way the police were going to allow this baby to be looked after by the mother."